Now that we have the stub of our data reference written, we can continue by actually implementing everything that the data reference needs to do. So to get on our feet, we're going to do what I think is always the safe bet for a reality check, and go look in PySystem Explorer. If we look at any of these attributes in PySystem Explorer, for example, the mass of the tank, that mass is associated with a data reference, in this case, the built-in formula data reference, and I can configure that formula data reference graphically. So this tells us one thing. A lot of data references can provide a graphical, custom graphical editor for their properties. But it also looks like anything that I do here graphically gets persisted just as a string down here for the configuration. If we look at level, which uses the PyPoint data reference, it's pretty much the same story. Everything that the level attribute needs to know, or said differently, everything that the PyPoint data reference needs to know about how to get tank 1's level is persisted here in this config string. So this is probably a good place to start for our custom data reference, is look at implementing this configuration string item. In other words, if I have a custom data reference, it needs to, when instantiated, need to know what it's supposed to do. If it's the PyPoint data reference, it needs to know what PyPoint am I supposed to go to. If it's the formula data reference, it needs to know what formula am I supposed to execute. So in our case, we're writing this bit mask data reference. Our data reference, when it gets instantiated, needs to know what is the target attribute that I am supposed to go and use as the source for these bits that I'm supposed to mask, and of those bits, what's the index of the one that I want. Okay, so these are two values that when my data reference gets instantiated, I need to be able to set those values in the data reference. And of course, if we ask the data reference about its configuration, it will be able to tell us what those values are. So we will begin by implementing the config string property. And we don't want to use this base implementation. We'll be providing our own. So we know the two things that we want this config string to involve. In other words, if someone comes in and sets a config string, what they're doing is they're telling us a string in some syntax, and we will be instantiating ourselves with a certain target attribute name and a certain index bit. If someone asks for our config string, that means that we need to tell them what our target attribute is that we're pointing at and what its index is. If we look again back in System Explorer, you'll notice that some of these data references have different syntaxes for their config string. In the OSIsoft standard config strings, the nomenclature that we use a lot, or the syntax that we use a lot, is key equals value semicolon. But in fact, you're welcome to use just about anything. You can use XML, you can use JSON, doesn't matter. As long as the syntax is something that you can parse, both when someone sets your config string, you understand it, and if someone asks for your config string, you can give them the config string in the proper syntax that you've chosen. We're going to go with that equals and semicolon delimited syntax here. So that means that if someone asks for our config string, we are going to build it out of whatever the target attribute name is and the index bit. To make our lives a little easier here, I'm going to assign some default values to these strings or rather to these properties here. So if someone asks for our config string, we need to build up a string that's delimited in, like, key1 equals value 1, key2 equals val2, and so on. So I'm going to use a string builder for this. That might be overkill in this situation, but that's kind of a general case. So key1 equals value, semicolon. And that first key will be the target attribute and the target attribute name. The second thing that we'll want to add is the same thing, except for the index bit. So when someone asks for our config string, we can build it out of whatever our current values are. And that should do the trick. Of course, when we get instantiated in the first place, it's likely that we will need to respond to an existing config string. Like, someone configured the config string for our attribute, and we need to instantiate ourselves with those specific values. So to respond to a config string, anything that we do will happen from parsing this value that we receive. So for each of these values that we get, delimited by semicolons, they should then be separated by an equal sign. So we will take that key value pair and split it by the equal sign and respond to its key and value. If someone puts in the key of target attribute, well, we want to take that target attribute, that value, and save it as our target attribute name. Likewise, if someone stipulates index bit, oops, that needs to be lowercase. There we go. Likewise, if someone puts in that they want to set the index bit, we will set the index bit to the provided value. Of course, it's advisable to have some error handling here, especially if we are not providing default values for some of these parameters that we want people to pass us. But here, we're going to keep the code a little cleaner and continue. So once we have handled all of the input from our configuration string, at the end, there's one very important step that we cannot forget. We need to tell the AFSDK that the config string has changed and that we need to persist those changes. There's a method that is one of the members of the AF data reference type, of course, that we're implementing here, called save config changes. Anytime we change the configuration string, we need to call that method. This should be it for our config string. So, to review how it works, when an attribute using this data reference gets instantiated, there is probably an existing config string that someone defined, like if they configure the attribute to have a certain config string, that config string gets passed to us. So in our code, we receive that config string here in the set accessor. We look at the value, we split it up, and we handle all of the contents. So we receive what the name of the target attribute is that we're supposed to be looking at, and the index bit that we are supposed to be looking at. Of course, we also need a way for the data reference and the AF server to respond to our data reference getting configured. Think about in System Explorer. If we come in and we use this setting dialog box, or we edit the config string manually, this config string needs to get saved back into the AF server. So, that means that if we want to save the data reference, this is config string, we need to ask the data reference what its current config string is. So that's where the get accessor comes in. If AF needs to ask this data reference how it's configured, the get accessor provides the current configuration of our data reference. So with that, we have the config string completely implemented, and we can move on to the methods that will support this data reference actually returning data.